Chapter 55, A Hard Life. Ruby was breathing heavily as she stared at Maya. The rabbit had fallen asleep an hour ago, but Ruby hadn't been able to do the same. The exposed skin peeking from the rabbit's thin nightgown had entranced Ruby and made her unable to sleep as her gaze roamed over Maya's body. It was taking all of her self-control to stop herself from leaping onto Maya. She took another deep breath to try to force herself to calm down, but Maya's scent invaded her mind again and made her tremble as her muscles strained against each other. Desperate, Ruby stuffed the cotton blanket into her mouth and bit down. The soft fabric was instantly shredded and her mouth was filled with fluff, making her spit out bits of bedding in annoyance. She couldn't take it anymore. Ruby slowly inched toward Maya and reached for her. She stroked Maya's shoulder, the sensation of her warm skin sending tingles through her arm as she licked her lips in anticipation. Her fingers twitched in excitement as she slowly began to move the strap of Maya's nightgown down her arm. Lowering her head, she took a deep sniff and began to drool, a strand of saliva beginning to drip from her mouth as she went in for a taste of flesh. Maya suddenly sat up with bright eyes and perked ears, making Ruby throw herself backwards and tumble off of the bed. "Shish," Maya whispered. She paused for a moment. "I think they're trying to escape." Ruby climbed back onto the bed, her face blushing red. She tried to form a cohesive thought as she regained her composure and wiped her mouth. She stuttered a bit before she was able to speak. "Didn't we say that we didn't care if they tried to escape?" Maya smoothed out her nightgown as she stood up. "I told the dog and cat that they could try to run if they wanted to because we had the wolf. But if they all tried to escape, we won't have anyone left to question." Ruby wanted to ask Maya if she had realized what Ruby had been doing, but she didn't really want to know the answer. Instead, she just got up and followed Maya. Maya was peeking through the slightly ajar door, looking down the hallway in search of the cause of disturbance. Maya muttered a silent curse as she opened the door and crept into the hallway. Ruby was right behind her and followed her gaze. She immediately caught sight of the crooked closet door. The wooden frame was intact, but the door was barely hanging onto the hinges. Maya paused for a second and flicked her ears, then continued to the closet. The sight of the wolf Faunus in his chair lying on the floor greeted her after she pushed the door to the side. The wolf was making odd muffled sounds and rocking back and forth in his chair as he tried to push himself up. He frantically shook his head as Maya moved forward and pulled him upright. The wolf's cries became more frantic and tears flowed out of his eyes as Maya pulled the rag out of his mouth. A torrent of blood flowed out of his mouth as Maya got the last pieces of tell out. The wolf coughed raggedly, sputum and saliva flecked with blood flying out of his mouth as he tried to clear his airway. Ruby sighed as the fluid splattered her already bloody tank top. Maya frowned as she saw the blood spilling out of his broken teeth. The wolf tried to talk, but his dislocated jaw shifted and the attempt at coherency turned into a keening wail. "Where's the lynx?" Maya asked him. The wolf stuttered. Behend. Maya leaned closer. "Speak slowly and clearly." "Bay." Ruby was suddenly falling to the ground, the floor coming up to meet her as she collapsed. The feeling of cold steel registered a moment later when the knife had already left her neck. Maya saw Ruby falling in the corner of her eye and immediately flared her aura. She turned to face the attacker and dodged a clumsy knife swing, the blade between the attacker's teeth. Before the attacker could try again, Maya had already kicked forward, her foot impacting the assailant's midsection and the knife clattering to the floor. Maya aimed another kick, earning a cry of pain from the attacker as she broke something. The attacker stumbled back and sat down, clutching her arm as she glared at Maya. Maya ran back to her room and grabbed a lantern before returning to the hallway. The light flooded the area as she turned it on and bent to examine Ruby. Maya growled as she saw the gash in the back of Ruby's neck, the knife having clipped Ruby's spinal cord. "Shit," Maya swore as she ripped a piece of fabric off of her nightgown. Shit. She turned Ruby over and wrapped the bandage around the gaping neck wound. The blood immediately soaked through the thin fabric as Maya tried to stem the bleeding. She hesitantly tightened the bandage a little more, careful not to accidentally strangle Ruby. Ruby tried to say, "Don't worry," but the flap of skin at her throat just expelled a bit of air. Her vocal cord also felt damaged, the knife having gone straight through her neck. She settled for blinking instead, making Maya exhale a sigh of relief as she saw that Ruby was still alive. "You're really fucking tough, aren't you?" Maya said, shaking her head and laughing, her voice wavering a little. Ruby twitched her mouth in an attempt to show her shared amusement. Maya got up from the floor and turned to look at the lynx slumped against the wall. The leg shackles were still around her ankles and her arms were still bound with steel silk, but she had managed to slip the tough material around her legs up to her torso. This had allowed her a limited range of movement that was enough to sneak to the kitchen and grab a knife in her teeth. "I should just kill you right now," Maya stated as she stood over her. "I have nothing to live for," the lynx said. "Kill me and get it over with." Maya flared her aura and swung at the lynx's head. The lynx just stared at Maya as Maya's fist slammed into the wall next to her and sent a cloud of dust and wood flying. "You're serious," Maya said contemplatively. "Of course I'm serious, you plant-eating piece of..." Maya slammed her head against the wall and knocked her out. "How much longer, Rose?" Maya asked as she walked back to Ruby. "One blink for each hour." Ruby thought for a moment, then blinked once. The blood flow was already beginning to slow, her body directing all of its resources to that one area. She could feel the edges of her skin moving closer, the wound opening closing up. Maya nodded. "I'll go tie up the lynx again. If you need anything, just, she shrugged. "Just tap the ground or something when you can move a bit." Ruby watched as Maya tended to the wolf. Firmly gripping his head, she manipulated his jaw back into place with an audible popping sound. The wolf let out another cry of pain as she held his mouth shut and bound his jaw in place with a strip of his clothing. The bandage wrapped around his head and under his chin. "Don't think that this will get you out of questioning," Maya warned him as she roughly knotted the piece of cloth. The wolf nodded, the simple motion sending tears of pain into his eyes. Maya twisted the steel silk into wire-like strands and threaded them through the lynx's leg cuffs a few times, then tied the ends together. The cuffs were now wrapped together, the lynx now unable to move her leg separately. The lynx's arm had been broken further, so Maya realigned the bone once more and redid the splint and bandages. Pulling out a key, she undid the handcuffs and moved the lynx's arms behind the lynx's back before cuffing her again. "Should have done this in the first place," Maya muttered to herself. Carrying the unconscious lynx on her shoulder, she moved the faunus back into the closet with the wolf and shut the door. Moving to the kitchen, she checked the time and peeked through one of the cracks in the boards that covered the window. "It's 4 o'clock, Maya announced as she walked back to Ruby. "Still snowing." She sat next to Ruby. "After you heal, we'll go check on the cat and dog pair together. They might have set a trap for us or woken up after hearing all of this commotion, so we'll need to be extra careful." She leaned back against the wall and sighed as she looked down at Ruby. "You're not invincible, you know." Ruby could only blink in response. "You might think you're, and trust me, I know how tough you're, but you are not invincible." Maya ran a hand through her long blue hair, tucking wayward strands behind her ears. "You need to be more careful, Rose. What if she didn't have both arms broken? She could have hacked through your head if she got a lucky hit and the knife went through your spine. You were lucky that she was holding the knife in her mouth. And next time, it might not even be a knife. It might be a machete, or an axe, or a few shotgun blasts to the head." Ruby blinked rapidly and tried to open her mouth to respond, but she couldn't utter a word. Maya made a placating gesture. "Okay, okay, so I didn't hear her either. But lynxes are really fucking sneaky, alright. Take my advice for things in general. You're not always going to be able to heal back up." Ruby made a questioning expression. "What, you think people are just going to let you lie there and heal after they've blown your brains out?" Maya chuckled darkly. "The first thing they do is chop you up into little pieces and burn the parts." Ruby grimaced. "Therefore," Maya continued, "you should keep your aura up if you're in a dangerous situation, like what happened tonight. True, it's a drain to keep it up all the time, but it should be fine if you just activate it during the critical moments." They sat in silence for a while, Maya swiveling her rabbit ears as she listened for any signs of escape from the other faunus. "So we have an hour to burn, huh?" Maya commented. "Have I told you about my past?" Ruby found that she could move her head a little, her neck muscles reattaching, so she delicately shook her head. "All right then," Maya said. She crossed her legs and made herself comfortable as she leaned forward. Her fingers idly traced circles on the hardwood floor as she began speaking softly. "I lived in a bad neighborhood for all of my childhood. A really, really bad neighborhood. You know about the war. The Faunus Rights Revolution." Ruby nodded slowly. "After everything ended, after we won our rights, we were allowed to spread out and settle down outside of the menagerie. We thought that we could go back into society, live among the humans, and show that we deserved the rights that we had just fought for." Maya shook her head. "But it wasn't that easy. Oh no, it couldn't be that easy. We were either denied the ability to live in human neighborhoods or we were constantly harassed and discriminated against if we moved in. Eventually we ended up in segregated neighborhoods." She motioned with her hands. "For example, the Faunus would live on this side of town, and the humans would live on the other, better, richer side of town. We tried to preserve our history, maintain our proud ancestry, but we failed. The communities became cramped ghettos, the buildings deteriorated, and the overall standard of living decreased dramatically. Faunus couldn't find jobs, education was poor, and so the children of the next few generations roamed the streets, forming gangs or working minimum wage jobs to make a living. They were essentially stuck in a cycle of self-destruction and urban decay, with nowhere to go yet unhappy with where they were." She let out a breath and crossed her arms as she leaned back against the wall. "So that's where I grew up. I'm not too proud to say that I didn't take school seriously, that I joined a gang and spent my days doing questionable activities. There are a few memories that I'd like to forget and things that I'm still trying to make up for. I eventually went back to school, graduated, and got a job as a police officer. Ironic, I know, but it seemed fitting at the time. I'd like to say that I was fond of my old neighborhood, that it was great to be able to make a difference for the better, but honestly, my job was nothing like that. I was in constant danger when I patrolled the neighborhoods. Previous friends tried to bribe me, tried to use my position as a police officer to avoid being arrested. When they realized that I wouldn't budge, they abandoned me. I eventually arrested quite a few of them too. So when one of my superiors came to me with the offer to join the police force in New Haven, I immediately agreed. I thought that I could get a fresh start, somewhere where I wouldn't be burdened by the past. Obviously, it hasn't really turned out that way. This place is nearly as bad as my old neighborhood." Maya yawned as she wrapped a strand of hair around her finger, tugging on it. "And that's my story. It's pretty depressing, but I'm glad I met you along the way." Her rabbit ears drooped a little as she rubbed her face and struggled to keep her eyes open. "Now I'm getting all sentimental," she said, smiling tiredly. Leaning over Ruby, she carefully unwrapped the bandage around her neck and checked to see if the wound was healing. Ruby tried to return her smile as Maya poked and prodded the area around the injury. The blood was only oozing slowly now, her flesh already knitting together. "Looks like you're healing up pretty well," Maya noted. "I'm gonna go take a nap. Wake me up when you're healed and ready to go check on the other prisoners with me." With that, she closed her eyes and fell asleep instantly. It took the better part of the hour for Ruby to feel as though her neck wasn't about to fall off and to regain full control of her body. After experimentally twitching each of her limbs, she pushed herself upright and cracked her neck from side to side, loosening the tightly healed muscle fibers. "Maya," Ruby whispered, "I'm okay now." Maya's eyes opened a fraction before she closed them again. "A few more minutes, Rose," she murmured. "Sure thing," Ruby said. She sat next to Maya, getting as close as possible, and watched her chest move up and down as she slept. A few minutes later, Maya's eyes blinked open as she let out a yawn. Ruby immediately shifted her gaze and watched Maya out of the corner of her eye as the rabbit Faunus stretched out her deliciously long legs. "Our sleep schedules are really messed up now, huh?" Maya commented. "Yup," Ruby agreed. "We haven't had a good night's sleep in ages." Maya rubbed her eyes wearily. "All right, screw the prisoners. Let's finish our interrogation today and try to send them out, blizzard or no blizzard. I'll either get someone to drive the snowplow over or we'll just drag them with us." Ruby grinned. "Sounds fun." As Maya stood up, the nightgown cascaded back down her body, momentarily distracting Ruby. Recovering quickly, she followed Maya to the guest bedroom. The two of them tried to be stealthy as they crept to the door. Maya listened for a second before turning the doorknob. The light from the lantern in the hallway illuminated the two figures on the bed. The cat Faunus let out an involuntary mew and the dog whimpered as they covered their eyes.
Good, good,
Maya muttered as she turned to leave. Wait, the cat Faunus croaked weakly. She cleared her throat.
We need to use the restroom, she said softly. And maybe, some water.
Sure, Maya said, nodding. Let me go get the keys.
Rose, watch them.
Ruby nodded and watched Maya's behind as she strode out of the room. Once Maya was out of sight, she turned back to the two prisoners.
So, Ruby drawled. How's it going?
They stared at her. She tried again. Did you have a good night's sleep?
Well, I mean, besides for the interruption, of course.
The cat hissed at her and the dog Faunus snarled.
Hey, Ruby said, stepping forward.
Come on, calm down. The cat Faunus shied back and swiped at Ruby, her hands harmlessly passing through the air. The dog Faunus tried to lunge at her, making the metal bed frame creak as he strained at his cuffs. Ruby looked forlorn as she backed away and folded her arms around herself. Maya came in a few moments later, a metal key in her hand. She looked at the cowering Faunus and Ruby's sad face and sighed. The rabbit Faunus unlocked the cuffs on the dog Faunus and gestured with her hand.
You first, she ordered.
The dog Faunus hesitated and looked back at the cat. After the cat Faunus had nodded slightly, he followed Maya into the hallway. The dog Faunus limped, his legs a little wobbly, and held an arm around his ribs. He tried to speak but his damaged tongue turned his words into gibberish, making him huff in frustration. After the dog Faunus was done, Maya led him back and shackled him to the bed again. As Maya unlocked the cat Faunus' cuffs, the prisoner gestured helplessly at her partially paralyzed legs after attempting to move them.
Let me carry you, Ruby offered.
The cat frantically shook her head and immediately backed up. Maya nodded. It's fine, Rose, I can carry her. The Faunus flailed a little as Maya slung the cat Faunus onto her shoulders. Ruby began following the two as they left the bedroom. It was a brief gleam that gave it away, the light from the lantern in the hallway reflected on the knife. Ruby blinked forward in a dash of petals and ripped the knife out of the cat Faunus' hand before throwing her against the wall. Maya reacted quickly, immediately spinning around and taking a few steps back.
Rose.
The cat Faunus cowered and held her side as Ruby stood over her, the knife in Ruby's hand. She almost stabbed you, Ruby breathed, her grip crushing and warping the knife. Maya paused for a moment before turning back to the frightened cat Faunus. What the hell were you trying to do? Maya shouted, growing angry. Tears flowed down the cat Faunus' face. Why you were going to kill us, she cried pitifully. Maya groaned in frustration. We weren't going to kill you, she said truthfully. We're going to release you today, all right. She noticed Ruby advancing on the injured prisoner.
Rose, put the knife down, Maya said. It was a misunderstanding.
You'd do the same in her position. Ruby growled, baring her teeth, then dropped the knife. The twisted metal hit the floor with a clang and made the cat flinch as it bounced toward her.
Rose, why don't you go guard the dog?
Maya gently suggested. Ruby gave Maya a quick hug. I'm glad you're okay, she whispered. Maya smiled, petting Ruby's head. Thank you for protecting me. She's going to kill him, the cat Faunus whimpered as Ruby headed back for the guest room. Maya picked up the misshapen knife and examined it. He'll be fine, Maya said dismissively, palming the metal. The dog Faunus seemed to have a little vision remaining in one of his eyes, his reaction to bright light evident of that, but he still sniffed the air before turning to face Ruby. The two faced each other for a few minutes, Ruby wondering if he could see her clearly, before Maya returned with a glass of water in her hand and the cat Faunus on her shoulder. The cat Faunus gasped in pain as Maya lowered her onto the bed and cuffed her limbs. The dog Faunus broke his gaze with Ruby and gently lifted his companion into his lap. After she had whispered into his ear, he took on a resigned expression and leaned back against the headboard, holding the cat Faunus in his arms. Maya handed them the glass of water. The two of them finished the glass in a few gulps. The dog Faunus tipped the glass back in an attempt to get the last few drops, then hefted the glassware in his hand, looking contemplative. Maya cleared her throat and frowned pointedly as she held her hand out.
The dog Faunus grimaced and set the glass in her hand before turning back to examining his companion. "We finish this now," Maya said as she closed the door. Turns out this house wasn't built for containing multiple prisoners. Ruby curiously followed her as Maya made a beeline for the kitchen. The rabbit Faunus stopped, glanced at the clock, then pulled a cleaver out of the knife block. "Do I get a knife?" Ruby asked eagerly as they headed back. Maya rolled her eyes but grinned anyways. "It's just for scaring him if he's still stubborn," Maya reminded her. "Alright, let's get this over with." Chapter 56, Whoops. "Grab the tablet," Maya said as she walked into the hallway. "Open up the voice recorder and keep it hidden." "Oh, I get it," Ruby said, picking up the tablet from the table. She looked down at herself. "Can I just put this down my shorts or something?" Maya looked faintly disgusted. "I'd rather you not, Rose. You realize you can just hold it behind your back, right?" "Right." The moment Maya opened the closet door, the lynx Faunus turned her head to glare at them. The wolf Faunus immediately began rocking back and forth in his chair as he tried to shuffle away from the lynx Faunus. "Helped," the wolf Faunus gurgled in terror. "Get me away from here." "Stop cowering," Maya said as she dragged his chair out of the closet. She can't even move. Ruby shut the closet door again, locking the other Faunus inside as Maya pulled the wolf Faunus to the living room. The rabbit Faunus scooted the couch out of the way and set him down in front of the fireplace. Maya sat on the couch directly across from him and looked into his eyes with an exasperated expression. She exaggerated her motion as she set the cleaver down on the couch and leaned forward. "I want you to speak clearly and tell me the truth," Maya said. She glanced at the cleaver. "Can you do that?" The wolf nodded vigorously. "Good. What happened? Why did the lynx hurt you?" It took the wolf a few tries to talk around his broken teeth and his previously dislocated jaw. "I tried to call for help to and stay lifted the owl in my mouth and the tomped on my face." Maya stared at him. "Oh, for God's sakes," she complained. "Can you repeat that again?" It took a minute and multiple attempts before she was able to understand him. Maya turned to the patiently standing Ruby and motioned Ruby toward her. Ruby leaned down and Maya whispered in her ear. "Just casually put the tablet on the table behind us. It'll be able to pick up sound from there. Meanwhile, I want you to try to get some information from the lynx." "Air, really?" Ruby whispered back. "You trust me with this? Think of this as a test. Don't kill her, don't cripple her, don't seriously injure her. I want you to stay in control of yourself, alright?" "Okay," Ruby said uncertainly. "You can do this," Maya assured her. She gave Ruby a gentle slap on her back. "Have some confidence." "Right," Ruby muttered. "Confidence." As she walked out of the room, she heard Maya begin her questioning. "What's your name?" Ellipsis quote. "I know what to do," Ruby told herself. She was walking down the hallway and taking her time as she planned out how she was going to interrogate the lynx Faunus. "Maybe I should copy Maya. Throw her down the stairs or something. Break her fingers. Or better, I could just eat her fingers. Maybe I could just eat her. I wouldn't kill her, of course. Maya said I couldn't. I could just eat her slowly, and she would scream in pain and tell me everything. That's how it works, right? I'll just eat parts of her until she confesses. Yeah, that's a good idea. I like it. I should start eating her immediately. Maya would be happy if I got faster results, right?" No. Ruby opened the closet door. The lynx was contorted in an awkward position as she fumbled at her leg cuffs and handcuffs, her arms still behind her back. The moment she saw Ruby come in, though, she stopped moving and fell limp. "Oh, it's really small in here. Maybe I should take her to the basement. Maya wouldn't like it if her closet got really messy. I could splatter less onto the walls if I brought her to the basement." Ruby easily picked up the lynx, slinging the prisoner onto her shoulder. The lynx hissed and tensed up. "Where are we going?" the lynx asked suspiciously. "Put me down." "Oh, I'm just relocating you to a bigger place," Ruby said absentmindedly. Ruby didn't notice as the Faunus began moving again. She entered the basement and closed the door behind her before walking down the steps. Meanwhile, the Faunus contorted and reached for her legs cuffs without her captor noticing. Taking advantage of Ruby's absent-mindedness, she worked desperately at the locks in her wrists and ankles. Ruby reached the bottom of the stairs and looked around. The room was mostly clear. A few stacks of firewood and a few of the yellow dust canisters she had seen a few days ago were still in the corner. Ruby dropped the links onto the floor. She let out a grunt as she twisted in midair, trying to avoid landing on her injured arms. "Hi there," Ruby began. "You should tell me who sent you, I think. If you don't, I'm going to eat you slowly and listen to you scream." "Fuck you," the lynx spat. In a flurry of motion, the lynx sprang up and kicked Ruby, knocking her off balance, then wrapped the steel silk she had managed to untangle around Ruby's throat. Ruby clawed at the strands of steel silk around her neck, her vision beginning to grow blurry as she lost circulation and began to choke. The lynx Faunus twisted the strands and tugged harder. She had one foot pressed against Ruby's back, which kept Ruby facing away from her and also increased the amount of pressure the wires exerted against Ruby's throat. Despite the faint glow of aura surrounding her, Ruby's neck began to bend at an awkward angle as the metal bit into her skin. The blood flowing from the wound coated her neck and chest in a sheet of blood. With a little ping, the thin strands of metal snapped under Ruby's fingertips. Her fingertips were completely shredded, the bone underneath finally proving hard enough to snap the metal. "Ah, fuck," the lynx cursed in anger. Ruby dizzily stumbled forward and hit the wall as she shook her head and tried to clear it. She left bloody handprints on the wall as she pushed herself upright. A thick cord of wood smashed into the back of her knee. The wood shattered against Ruby's aura, but Ruby still stumbled as the lynx Faunus attempted to dash past her and up the stairs. But Ruby's mind had already cleared, so she grabbed onto the lynx Faunus and threw her back into the basement even as she dropped to one knee. Slowly standing up, she began hobbling toward the panicking lynx. "I don't want to fucking die," the lynx said frantically as she backed away. "I was just putting up a front so I could get myself free. Get the fuck away and I'll tell you everything." Ruby ignored her excuses as she made her way toward the lynx Faunus. The lynx was looking around desperately and searching for something to use. Ruby was nearly within arm's reach of the lynx Faunus when she suddenly turned and threw one of the large containers of yellow dust at her. Ruby reacted instinctively and swiped it out of the air with her forearm, shattering it and sending clouds of yellow dust billowing into the room. The lynx gasped in horror at what she had done and immediately began to cough. Ruby sneezed. An explosion rocked the basement as the dust ignited and exploded. Flames immediately began spreading across the basement walls, the fire eagerly licking at the bundles of firewood. Ruby was thrown back toward the stairs. Her aura had protected her from part of the explosion, but her face and arms still felt burnt and she couldn't see out of one of her eyes. The unfortunate lynx Faunus had caught the brunt of the blast. Her charred body was laying in bits around the room, a few less burnt organs decorating the wall in various shades of red and pink and orange. Ruby's head was ringing again as she slowly got up and headed for the stairs. The basement was becoming an inferno, the fire fueled by the dry wood and the wooden walls. Rose. The basement door was flung open, revealing Maya looking down the stairs. Ruby gave her a weak wave as she made her way up. Maya grimaced as she caught sight of Ruby's face, the mangled flesh illuminated against the backdrop of the fire. She raced down the stairs and picked Ruby up, ignoring her protests. "Sorry," Ruby apologized. "It's fine," Maya said as she carried Ruby into the hallway. "It's not my house anyways." As she ran into the living room, she grabbed the tablet from the table and stuffed it down the front of her nightgown, then dragged the wolf in the chair with her as she ran out of the house. "Stay here," Maya ordered as she deposited Ruby into the snow. Ruby nodded. The swirling snowstorm obscured her vision as she watched Maya run back into the house. Ruby wanted to help her. She straightened out her knee and felt a crack as the bones realigned, the lynx Faunus's blow having previously knocked them out of place. The wolf's eyes were wide open as he stared at her injured face and watched her fix her leg. Ruby ignored him as she stretched out her arms and cracked the layer of dried blood that was forming on her skin. The cold weather was already cooling her burn wounds down. She tentatively blinked her left eye and made sure that the contact lens was still in there. In her right eye, however, the lens had been fused to her eyeball. She was already beginning to grow hungry, her body immensely taxed by the amount of damage it was being forced to heal. Still lying in the snow, she turned to look at the wolf Faunus and sniff the air. The Faunus had accumulated some bruises and cuts throughout the whole ordeal and looked like an easy target to Ruby. A snack before I go, Ruby decided. Shaking bits of ice off of herself, she slowly got up. She cracked her jaw and grinned, revealing her sharp teeth as she made her way toward the wolf. Maya appeared out of the swirling storm. She was leading the dog Faunus in one arm and carrying the cat Faunus over her other shoulder. "Behave yourself, Rose," Maya said as she set the cat Faunus into the dog Faunus's arms. Ruby blinked, surprised, rocking back onto her heels. It took her a few seconds to regain her senses. "Maya, I need to go back in. My stuff is still in there." Maya looked at her frowning, then turned back to look at the smoking house. "If you say so. But if I see you go down, the first thing I'm gonna do is drag your ass back out of the house, alright?" Ruby nodded, sprinting for the house. "I'm going to grab the safe," she shouted. Maya looked at the three Faunus in front of her. "If you want to leave, go ahead. I don't need anything from you three anymore. Have fun in the blizzard." Without a second glance, she ran back toward the house. "Rose, wait." Ruby looked back from the doorway. "What?" she yelled. "I need to go save all of my stuff." Maya caught up to her before speaking and grabbed her hand. "The safe will be fine if the house collapses. You won't be." Ruby hesitated. "But..." Maya interrupted her. "We have no time, Ruby. We need to get our other supplies out before the whole thing burns down." "Are you sure, Maya?" Ruby asked pleadingly. 100% sure. "Yes," Maya said impatiently. "House fires aren't hot enough to melt metal. Let's go already." After another moment of hesitation, Ruby nodded, and the two of them ran into the house. "You're stronger than me," Maya said. "Grab the dresser with our clothes and move it outside. Don't break it, I don't want to be searching for clothes in the middle of a blizzard." Smoke was beginning to seep through the cracks of the basement door as Ruby ran into Maya's room. With a quiet grunt, she hefted the piece of furniture and hugged it to her body as she ran out the door. The drawer didn't perfectly fit through the door frame, and Ruby was in a hurry, so a corner of the wooden drawer smashed through the drywall as she stumbled into the hallway. "Oops," Ruby muttered to herself. Maya came out of the bathroom with a large laundry hamper in her arms. It was filled to the brim with the contents of the bathroom cabinets and other clothes, and Ruby thought she could see the edge of her police uniform poking out. "Move," Maya shouted, her voice filled with urgency. Ruby heard creaking sounds as her feet slammed into the floorboards, each step making her wonder if she was about to fall through the floor. Maya was right behind her, her head turning side to side as she scanned the room to make sure nothing else was left behind. The front door was a tight fit again, so Ruby adjusted her grip on the drawer and managed to only clip a tiny piece of the door frame before she made it outside. The snow immediately began obscuring her vision, the howling wind blowing bits of ice into her face. Maya's hair whipped to the side in the wind as she stood in the doorway and took one last glance at the interior of the house. She bent down to pick up their boots from the entryway and tossed them away from the house and into the snow. "Do you think I should get the knives?" Maya asked Ruby. Ruby shrugged. "I just want the house to burn down so I can get my stuff," she said. "Then we'll just wait." They backed off to a safe distance and Ruby set down the dresser. The dresser was smeared with blood from Ruby's shredded fingertips. Ruby wiped her hands and her shorts as she watched the house smolder. The other Faunus seemed to be gone, a trail of footsteps leading back to the main city. The wolf Faunus chair lay sideways in the snow, the steel silk ribbon scattered around the chair. Ruby gathered up the steel silk as Maya hopped onto the dresser and sat cross-legged, massaging her feet. "Phew, freaking cold," she muttered to herself. She looked up. "Rose, do you mind getting my boots? My toes are freezing off." "Sure," Ruby said, looking around. "Where are they?" Maya pointed to the indents in the snow and Ruby slogged over to the shoes. She threw Maya her pair of boots before putting her own on and walking over to Maya. Maya wordlessly slid over and patted the spot beside her. Ruby sat down next to her and leaned against her, feeling Maya begin to shiver under her nightgown. Ruby tried to warm her up, hugging her, and also took the opportunity to surreptitiously touch the rabbit in various places. "Not helping, Rose," Maya said after a few minutes, her teeth chattering and her hair covered in snow. You're still really cold. There's a blanket in the bag and a coat in the laundry basket. Ruby had just hopped to the ground to grab the clothing when a soft cracking sound emanated from the house. She was just able to make out part of the roof collapsing, the blizzard nearly obscuring the puff of smoke that came out of the wreckage. Ruby handed a parka and a blanket to Maya before setting off for the house. Wait, Maya said. You should stay back. The other tubes of dust might have leaked, so there might be some more dust explosions before the whole thing settles down. Ruby huffed a little, impatient to get to her weapon, and sat back down onto the dresser. So why didn't the other containers explode when I set off the explosion in the first place? Maya paused in her process of bundling herself up and stared at her. You set off the explosion. I thought Lynx did some sort of suicide bombing attempt. I think it was an accident, Ruby said. She threw it at me, I broke it, dust went everywhere, and then I sneezed. Damn, Maya said, shaking her head. The other dust didn't ignite because I keep explosive material like dust in blast-resistant containers. It's pretty surprising you even managed to break it. What were you doing in the basement anyways? Ruby began to speak but paused, revising a few details in her mind as she realized what she had nearly done. Oh, well, I wanted to keep things nice and clean, and, have bigger space to work with. Stupid mistake, Maya sighed. But I guess I should have pointed the dust out to you. At least I don't actually own this house. So I assume that the Lynx is dead. Ruby nodded and gestured with her hands. She exploded. Boom. Splattered everywhere. Aren't you at least a little traumatized? Ruby shook her head. I've seen worse. Right, Maya said. Ruby blinked the snow out of her eyelashes as she watched the house fire slowly fade away, running out of wood to burn. The howling winds and cold temperatures were also putting out the fire, and steam was rising from the ruins as snow continued to pelt the smoldering wood. Despite the weather conditions, Ruby wondered whether anyone else would be able to see the smoke. How are we going to explain this? Maya asked. Her eyes were half closed as she buried herself in the blanket. Ruby pointed at the house. If someone asks us what happened to the house, what are we supposed to say? Maya yawned. An unfortunate dust accident occurred, I suppose. It's a damn shame that we lost all of the firewood. Maya blinked sleepily and looked around, then shook the snow out of her hair. Those idiots really went off by themselves, she commented. If they're lucky, they'll make it to town with maybe some mild frostbite. If they aren't, we'll probably be finding their half-frozen bodies in the snow after the storm goes away. Do you think we should tell the police department? Why not? Maya shrugged, pulling out the tablet. Her fingers fumbled with the device a little, the cold making her fingers stiff. Rose, can you get the lantern out of the laundry basket? It's buried underneath all of the other stuff. Ruby took the lantern out and flicked it on. A soft yellow glow spread out around them as Maya warmed her fingers on the glass surface before resuming her tapping on the tablet. Hello. Yes, I know it's early. My house burnt down. Dust accident. Three escaped, one died. Maya glanced at Ruby. Yes, one of the prisoners set off the dust explosion. I'm fine. I know you can't send help. Alright. Yes, I know. Okay. Bye. Maya swiped the tablet shut and dropped it into the hamper. She moved the lantern closer to herself before speaking. Alright, Rose, so here's the plan. Chapter 57, Moving In. We're going to relocate to one of the empty houses down the street, Maya explained, wrapping the blanket tighter around herself. Which means we're going to break into one of the houses and claim it as our own. Most of the houses are recent constructions, so I'm hoping we won't have to do much searching to find a house with a working plumbing system. Assuming that the blizzard continues, most people are going to be staying inside. That means you probably won't have to go to your job, so I was wondering if you could go get some more supplies from town, and if you have time, some firewood. I can do that, Ruby agreed. What about you? I need to go to work, Maya said, grimacing. Police still have to be active during these times, especially since there might be looters or robbers trying to take advantage of the situation. And of course, some people might actually need help if they're stranded. Maya reached into the laundry hamper and pulled out her wallet from the pocket of a pair of pants. Here's some lean, Maya said, handing Ruby a bound stack of plastic credits. Try to budget the money. Make smart purchases. If you think someone is trying to scam you, call them out on it. And if you get lost, just call or message me and I can give you directions. In fact, Maya said, grabbing the tablet again, let me just give you the directions right now. I'll tell you where to buy stuff from so you won't have to spend the entire day searching for the right store. Air, won't they be closed? Ruby asked, slipping the credits into her top. It depends, Maya said. If the Faunus live in their store, they'll probably open up if you knock on the door to get their attention. Otherwise, then yeah, the stores will be closed. She closed the tablet and set it down, then began to warm her hands against the lantern again. I just sent you a list of a few places that might be open, along with some basic supplies we'll need if the blizzard continues. I doubt any restaurants will be open, so getting consumables will be your first priority. Okay, Ruby agreed. And if you want to save some money, I can go get some of the meat back at camp or I can go hunting. Maya nodded as she hopped off of the dresser, her boots crunching in the snow as she kept the blanket wrapped around herself. I think the house should be sufficiently cool by now, Maya said, walking toward the ruins. Ruby got up and followed her. Will my stuff be okay? The safe is a solid block of metal. It should be fine, but we'll probably have to do a lot of digging if anything collapsed on it. The front of the house was still standing, the front door still wide open. Ruby could see a gaping hole in the middle of the floor, the wood around it blackened, and the interior of the hole filled with wooden beams from the roof. As they got closer, the sound of sizzling water was audible as the falling snow hit the wooden beams. Ruby kneeled at the edge of the hole and began to lower herself in, but Maya shook her head. Try the stairs first, Maya suggested. We're not in that much of a hurry. They'll understand if I get to work late because my house burned down. Right, Ruby said nervously, quickly walking to the basement. The floor collapsed, and she barely had time to let out a squeak of surprise before falling through and smashing into the wreckage below. A spear of wood pierced her thigh as she landed awkwardly in her back. Rose, Maya asked, you okay down there? Perfectly fine, Ruby lied, ripping the shard of wood out of her leg. It was a nice little shortcut. Ruby looked up and reoriented herself using the floor above her. She had landed near the base of the stairs, at the edge of the main wreckage. A few larger beams of wood stuck out of the main pile of rubble and blocked her way to the safe, so she flared her aura and smashed her way through. Ruby ripped out the burnt pieces of the wall inside with relief as she pulled the safe out. The safe's exterior was covered with a layer of ash but was otherwise intact. She twisted the lock and frowned as she realized that she didn't have the key. Maya, I need the key, Ruby yelled, craning her head to look at her. Could you get it and throw it down here? Maya looked down into the basement. Yeah, give me a second, I'll be right back. As Maya jogged out of sight, Ruby flared her aura and began twisting the handle of the safe. She stopped when she realized that Maya might get angry if she ruined it, and instead decided to shake it and listen to her weapon slide around inside. I'm back, Maya called. Here, catch. Ruby looked up and held out her hand, indicating for Maya to drop the key. Ruby snatched it out of the air and immediately inserted it into the lock, frantically twisting and pulling until the safe's door swung open. Her belongings were inside, untouched by the fire. Ruby hurriedly slid her weapon out and unfolded it, shuddering with delight as she touched her precious. She stroked the cool metal with her fingertips, caressing the blade and letting it nick her skin, and made a mental note to do maintenance on the weapon the next time she was free. Maya just watched from above, her arms crossed and eyebrows raised, a small smile on her face as she watched Ruby refamiliarize herself with her weapon. Ruby looked up after a minute of cradling her weapon, feeling embarrassed as she realized that Maya had been watching her the entire time. She grabbed the bundle of cloth that held her belongings with her free hand and began climbing the pile of wood in the center of the room, stabbing her side into the larger pieces to keep herself steady on the unstable mound. Do you see any tubes of dust down there? Maya asked. Ruby paused and looked around. I think I see one sticking out of this pile of wood. Do you want me to look for the other ones? Maya considered it for a second before shaking her head. That should be enough, I think. I'll see if I can get more today. Ruby hopped down the pile to grab the tube of dust, stuffing it into her bundle, then resumed climbing. When she reached the top of the pile, she leapt toward the floor above her. She easily cleared the height and slammed her side into the floor to slow herself down, her boots skidding on the snow-covered floorboards. After coming to a stop, she ripped the side out of the floor and folded it shut, tucking it under her arm. "What happened to your leg?" Maya asked, noticing the trickle of blood down her pale thigh. Ruby touched the wound and found a scab already forming. "I landed on a sharp piece of wood," she admitted sheepishly. "Don't look so worried. I'm okay, it stopped bleeding already." Her stomach growled. "I'm a little hungry, though. Can you wait a little longer?" Maya asked. Ruby nodded. "Then we'll find a house first, and then you can go back to your camp and get some food," Maya decided. "Do you mind grabbing the dresser?" "No problem," Ruby said, setting her bundle and weapon on top of the dresser and picking it up. Maya pointed toward one of the neighboring houses. "We'll head toward that one. Try not to slip in the snow and break anything." Hefting her own laundry basket, Maya set out toward the house with Ruby in tow. The weight of the cabinet caused Ruby to sink down to knee level in the snow as she walked, a bit of ice making its way into her boot, but she ignored it and soldiered on. The uneven landscape hidden underneath the snow made her stumble, but she managed to right herself before struggling after Maya, who seemed to be having little difficulty navigating the terrain. The neighboring house was a little further from the wall than the old house, but it looked almost exactly the same. Maya set down her hamper and fished out a set of keys. She tried them on the lock and frowned. "Guess I'll have to go through the kitchen window," she muttered. Ruby set the drawer down and stretched out her stiff limbs, then checked to make sure that her belongings were okay. Maya disappeared off to the side of the house, and Ruby heard a tiny crack as Maya broke the latches on the shutter. A few seconds later, the front door opened up and Maya stepped back outside. The two of them hefted their burdens and maneuvered themselves through the doorway, Ruby taking extra time to make sure she didn't damage this house as well. The layout of the interior was the same as their previous house, so Ruby carried the dresser back to what she assumed would be Maya's room. The bedrooms contained beds with mattresses stored in waterproof plastic storage bags. Maya followed Ruby into the room and set the hamper down, then began sorting through the clothes and utilities she had placed inside. She flicked the dimming lantern on and headed to the bathroom with an armload of items. Ruby looked down at herself, shrugged, then took the credits out of her top and began changing out of her clothes. She was struggling out of her top when Maya came back in, a towel draped on her arm. A sudden wave of self-consciousness overtook her, making her blush as she tried to pull her top back on. Maya didn't seem to notice. "Take a shower before you change," she said. "I checked, the plumbing still works. If you need anything, just ask. And see what you can do about your injured eye." Ruby blinked experimentally as she realized that she still wasn't able to see out of her right eye. She hadn't really noticed her lack of vision in the blizzard outside, but with the lantern now dimly illuminating the room, her right eye's blindness became apparent. "Is the contact still stuck in there?" Ruby asked, her lack of clothing momentarily forgotten as she moved her head closer to Maya and pointed at her eye. Maya nodded as she brushed a hand against Ruby's face, bits of dried blood flaking off beneath her fingers. "Wash the blood off in the shower and see how much damage the explosion did. If it's too visible, I can bandage the area so it won't be as noticeable." Ruby took the towel from her and covered herself up, smiling gratefully. "Don't worry, my scars fade after a while," Ruby assured her. "The bandage idea sounds good for now, though. People would probably wonder how I suddenly got scars on my face." She began making her way to the bathroom, Maya following her with the dust lantern. A wave of dizziness swept her as she took a few steps down the hallway, her lack of depth perception and hunger disorienting her. She managed to trip over her own feet and stumble into the wall as she let out a small yelp. "Here, let me help you," Maya said as she offered her shoulder to Ruby. Ruby braced herself against the Faunus's shoulder and continued toward the bathroom. "I'll be fine," Ruby mumbled. "Just need to catch my breath." "Uh-huh," Maya said disbelievingly. The bathroom was a little cramped and poorly lit. The window shutters were closed and latched, the only source of light the dimming dust lantern. Ruby let go of Maya as she stepped into the shower and supported herself against the shower wall. "I need to take this towel off now," Ruby said, blushing. Maya frowned a little as she looked at Ruby. We may have to revise our plans, Maya said. Call me when you're done with the shower, all right? I don't want you slipping and cracking your head open or something. Okay, okay, Ruby agreed. Geez, why are you so worried? Maya raised an eyebrow. You were caught in a dust explosion, impaled in the leg, and you're blind in one eye. You look exhausted and hungry. Why wouldn't I be worried? Ruby opened her mouth to protest but couldn't find anything to say. Maya chuckled. Right, I'll leave you to your shower now. Ruby made sure Maya had left the room before taking the towel off and placing it on top of the counter. She turned the shower knob most of the way to the right before tugging it toward her. The stream of water that came out was ice cold at first, but Ruby didn't pay it any mind as she began washing her hair. By the time she was clean, she was sitting down on the floor of the bathtub, the steaming water beginning to turn cold again as it splashed against her head. She was nearly asleep, the warmth of the water and her complaining body encouraging her to rest. The task of shutting off the flow of water felt monumental, but Ruby managed to weakly raise an arm and flail at the shower knob until the water stopped. I'm done, Ruby called to Maya, feeling a little ridiculous. She barely managed to get to her feet and grab her towel before Maya came in, triumphantly holding a can of food. She had already dressed in her work clothes, her uniform, belt, and boots neatly in place. Look what I found, Maya said, helping Ruby out of the shower. Food. I nearly forgot that all of the houses are stocked for emergencies. Food? Ruby asked, her stomach growling at the mention of the word. Is it edible? Maya shrugged. Probably. It can't have been here for long. She looked at the can. Some sort of ground meat, I think. Ruby looked at the small can, her fingers clenching her towel as she resisted the temptation to grab the can and rip it open and devour its contents. Is there any more? I don't think that's enough for me. There's more, Maya promised. Besides, you're not in any condition to go back to your camp. Go put on your clothes and we'll go eat. I've already hung up our clothes in the closet and sorted out the dresser. Can I have some food right now? Ruby asked pleadingly. Please. Maya took a glance at Ruby. Wait right here, she said quickly, setting down the can. Let me go grab the can opener and open a few more cans. Ruby snatched the container and immediately began prying at it, the thin metal easily tearing apart beneath her fingers. She raised it over her mouth, making sure to catch most of the meat as she tore the can apart and began eating it with her fingers. And some utensils, Maya amended before leaving the room. Ruby finished the small tin of meat quickly, immediately feeling better despite still being hungry. She readjusted her towel and grabbed the lantern, then made her way to the kitchen. Maya was opening up more cans, glancing up as Ruby walked in and set the empty tin on the countertop. Feeling better? Yup. Still hungry, though. Maya gestured toward the counter. I've opened up some more cans so you won't have to mangle them. I've got to go to work soon, so try not to make a mess. Ruby chose one at random and began eating, the taste of ham filling her mouth. How are you going to get to work? She asked through a mouthful of food. Finish eating before you speak, Maya scolded her. I'll have to walk there by myself. Hopefully the snow lets up a bit so I don't freeze to death. Ruby swallowed her mouthful. Wait, let me go with you, she said hurriedly. I have to go shopping too, remember? Maya nodded. Yeah, we can go together. She set the can opener down. Okay, let me take a look at your face, she said, bringing the lantern closer. Ruby sat still as Maya shined the light on her face. I think the contact is stuck in my eye. Ahem. Seems so. Maya poked the skin around her eye. Does this hurt? Ruby shook her head. The burns seem to have mostly healed, but there are still some scars that are pretty noticeable. Does the contact in your left eye feel uncomfortable in any way? Ruby blinked her undamaged eye, realizing that she forgot to take it out before showering. I almost forgot it was there, Ruby confessed. Is it okay to leave it in? You can leave those in for a week or two. Those are permeable soft contacts, Maya explained. Great, so I can just leave them on for today. Yeah, it'd probably still be better if you took them off tonight like you usually do. You don't want to run the risk of getting some sort of infection and going blind in both eyes. Ruby made a muffled sound of agreement as she continued eating. Maya handed her a spoon and also began to eat. As they ate, Maya swiped her tablet open from where it lay on the countertop and checked the time. "Let's finish eating quickly. I still need to bandage your face and I'm already late to work." Ruby cleaned out the bottom of the can of tuna and set her spoon down. "I'm good for now. I'll eat more when I get back. I'll go get dressed while you eat." "Good idea. Meet me in the bathroom when you're ready. I'll have the bandages and tape there." Making sure that the towel didn't slip, Ruby walked back to their bedroom and began looking for clothes to wear. She took her undergarments from the dresser and grabbed a long-sleeved shirt from the closet. After choosing a pair of gray sweatpants over a pair of jeans and transferring the lean over to the pants, she headed toward the bathroom. Ruby was searching for the bandages and tape as Maya came in, carrying the lantern. She washed her hands and face, then pulled open one of the cabinets at along the bottom of the sink. Maya gestured toward the mirror. "You should probably take a look at your face if you haven't already. Your injuries looked really bad a few hours ago, but your skin has healed over quite quickly. The scars are also surprisingly small, probably because your aura took the brunt of the blast, but they're still noticeable. How long do you think you'll take to fully heal?" Ruby used the dim light of the lantern to check her face in the mirror. A few red marks showed on the right side of her face, some of the flash burns crossing over her eye. Her right eye was still blind, the blue contact melted into it. "These don't look too bad," Ruby decided. "Maybe a few days. I don't know about the contact that's stuck in my eye, though." Maya shrugged. "Give it some time, then. Maybe your body will reject it like it did with the metal knives." She began to unwind the roll of bandages. "I'm going to put the gauze pad over your eye before I wrap the right side of your face with bandages, alright? The main thing we're trying to do here is to hide the severity of your injuries, so that when you heal up people won't start asking questions." "What if the contact never comes out?" Ruby asked worriedly. "Then we can just cut it out. I don't want to mess around with it for now, though, in case we injure your eye permanently in some way. Unless you've had eye wounds in the past." Ruby shook her head. "Then we'll wait a few days and see what happens." Maya put the finishing touches on the head wrap, taping the ends together, then stood back and admired her work. "I think I've done a fairly good job," she said as she dropped the supplies back into the cabinet. Ruby examined herself in the mirror. The bandages covered the right half of her face, and the thick gauze pad was a little uncomfortable against her eye. The disconcerting feeling of missing half her vision and the way the bandage pressed her hair against her head was uncomfortable, but the wrap did a good job of disguising her injuries and it only covered the minimal amount necessary, so Ruby didn't complain. "We should probably go now." Maya's ears twitched. "I think the blizzard may have died down a bit, although it might start up again." "Right," Ruby said, looking away from the mirror. She took a few steps forward, her body and mind already beginning to compensate for the loss of depth perception. Maya walked with her, ready to catch her if she stumbled again. As they headed toward the front door, Maya grabbed her tablet and slipped it into her bag, then pulled on her thick parka. Ruby also stopped to take her tablet out of her pouch and slip it into the deep pockets of her sweatpants before putting on her boots and opening the door. Maya pulled on her hood as a blast of cold air and snow greeted them. She muttered a curse under her breath. "I'll go ahead of you," Ruby offered. "I can block some of the wind." "You're going to get lost," Maya pointed out. Ruby scoffed. "I'll be fine. I just need to follow the road and walk toward the city, right?" Maya looked down at the thigh-deep snow. "Rose, have you gone blind in both eyes?" Ruby looked down, mildly surprised. "Oh." The two of them began walking toward town, Maya leading the way.